And so for this to happen, first off, I just want to make some acknowledgments to various people that have allowed this to really take shape. First off, I have to thank my team at the Water, Climate, and Health Program. This includes Megan Langle, who's our program manager, City, Young Jin, and Connor for all their help in helping support that and that initiative that we're moving forward on and growing as well. And then also, there's a various number of people at the University of Nebraska Medical Center and the University of Nebraska Lincoln, and external people as well that have helped us build this Water, Climate, and Health Program, and which has allowed us to have a more of a focus on climate change here at UNMC and across the University of Nebraska Medical Center, or University of Nebraska as a whole. And the stuff that we're doing within the University of Nebraska Medical Center around climate change and climate and health, it wouldn't be possible without our institutional support from our deans. And so this is one of the things I've been really excited about and really happy about is across the board, we've had a lot of support from the various deans throughout the University of Nebraska Medical Center. We've met on numerous occasions talking about how do we better integrate climate change into the curriculum. And so I think we have a really exciting opportunity to try to build and expand some of the work that we're doing. Obviously, we're pretty early in the game, but with that being the case, there's a lot that we can do moving forward with this level of commitment and interest in this particular topic. So with that, I just want to move over to the next slide, please. And so I put this in here because whenever we talk about, I remember when I first came to the University of Nebraska Medical Center and people were some of my colleagues were kind of joking with me. They were like, well, why would you go to Nebraska if you're working on climate change? And I always kind of equated to this is that, well, you know, there's a lot of good work going on around the country. And there's a lot of places where you already have a lot of people invested in doing work around climate, and especially climate and health. That's not true of everywhere across the United States. And so there needs to be more work in various states and various locations. And so that's where I think we are at the University of Nebraska Medical Center. The meter might not have moved as far as some other places, but there's a lot of opportunity to move that meter. And there's a really good engagement here at the university around some of these efforts. And so I'm excited about where we're going and some of the developments that we've had. And Connor will talk about some of those in just a little bit. Next slide, please. And so first off, I wanted to talk about the new initiative within the University of Nebraska and the University of Nebraska Medical Center around water, climate, and health. We have the new Water, Climate, and Health Program. This came from very generous support from the Clarem Hubbard Foundation. This is about a $5 million investment to the University of Nebraska to help support water, climate, and health. And the whole scope of this, so some of that is in association with the broader University of Nebraska. And then this particular, the program itself is at the University of Nebraska Medical Center. And the Water, Climate, and Health Program is designed to build interdisciplinary collaborations across University of Nebraska system to help address Nebraska's public health challenges associated with water and climate. And we're going to be doing this through research, education, policy development, and training. This program just got started in the last year. We actually, our first, the program manager, that's when I say the official start date was when we hired the program manager, Megan Langle, was in September of last year. So we're still pretty new, but with that, we're growing at a pretty fast pace as well. And there's a lot of opportunities as we move forward. And you're going to hopefully hear about some of those opportunities and some of the work that we've been focusing on. Next slide, please. And so this is also tied in to a broader initiative across the University of Nebraska. So there's the Water, Climate, and Health Program, which is at the University of Nebraska. And then there's the Water, Climate, and Health Initiative that's within the Water for Food Global Institute at the University of Nebraska. And as we refer to it as DWFI, that's across the entire University of Nebraska system. And so there's a variety of different ways that we're able to now engage across not just the University of Nebraska Medical Center, but University of Nebraska Lincoln, University of Nebraska Omaha, and University of Nebraska Kearney as well, around some of these efforts and better trying to understand how changes in climate and changes in our environment are impacting human health, especially here in the state. And so Water for Food, the mission of Water for Food is to have a lasting a significant impact on achieving more food security with less pressure on scarce water resources by conducting scientific and policy research. And the vision is basically around water and food security. And so with that, we felt like it's a really good tie-in within that program to try to get better engagement across the university and trying to engage with some of the programs already existing here in the state as well. Next slide, please. And so when you talk about moving the meter, one of the things that we're already seeing and one of the things that really appealed to me coming to the University of Nebraska is that there was already a lot of effort. There was effort already in this area and in this space. The Med Center had already announced before I even came here, which I showed up at 2018, the summer of 2018. So before that, the Med Center had already announced that they had sustainability goals for UNMC. And one of the things that they wanted to do is become carbon neutral by 2030, zero waste by 2030, and then also reduce water usage as well across the campus by 2030. And so they had already been moving in that direction around sustainability because the university as a whole found this to be something of importance to them. Next slide, please. And, you know, obviously, if you're familiar with Nebraska, many people aren't. It's a flyover state for some. So one of the things that you might notice or you might realize is that, you know, we're not a densely populated state. It's largely a rural state, but Omaha is the largest urban area within Omaha, which is where the medical center is located. And in 2019, the medical center installed the largest rooftop solar array in the state of Nebraska. There was 1,487 solar panels on three different campus buildings at the University of Nebraska Medical Center, and that are now helping generate power for each one of these buildings. I'm currently in one of those buildings on the campus that has solar panels on top of the roof. And you'll see the solar panels over there on the right side as well. And then with some of our initiatives, if you're interested in some of our initiatives around sustainability, I recommend going to the website at the bottom of the screen, livegreennebraska.com. Those focus on the initiatives around sustainability at the University of Nebraska Medical Center. All right, next slide, please. And so that's some of our sustainability efforts. That's some of our programmatic efforts that we're doing here at the focused on here at the University of Nebraska Medical Center. But we're also trying to do more engagement around education, especially education of climate change and the impacts that it has on human health. Within the College of Public Health, we already are offering a climate change and human health course. We've also integrated climate change lectures into various other classes in the College of Public Health, and then also within the annual agricultural health and safety for healthcare and safety professional course that happens every summer. And this is for ag professionals and professionals working across the state that are trying to get health certified. Climate change is one of the focal areas within that certification process. Within the College of Medicine, we're developing different activities, and Connor's going to talk about those in just a little bit. But during the pandemic and everything, when everything had to shift focus, and a lot of medical schools were trying to figure out what to do, one of the things that the College of Medicine did was put together impact of infectious disease rotation, which was basically a series of courses talking about infectious disease. And one of the lectures that took place was actually on climate and the impacts it has on infectious disease. I gave that particular lecture. And the reason that that occurred was because of student interest and pushing to better understand how climate change was impacting infectious disease. And then outside of UNMC, we've had integration of how climate is impacting human health at within courses at UNL and UNO, adult continuing education courses, conferences, and then we've also had some engagement with Creighton University that's located right here at the university or within Omaha as well. Next slide, please. And this illustrates some of the other efforts that we're starting to see here at Nebraska as well. This year, Nebraska every year holds their public health conference, their annual public health conference. And this year in 2021, the focus was on climate change and how climate change impacts human health. And so we had Paul Schramm, which I'm sure some of you probably have met or know, he remotely gave a keynote talking about the climate and health program at CDC and some of the initiatives that they're doing with states cities around climate change and climate change preparedness. Next slide, please. And so this is where I'm going to hand it over to Conor. Basically, I just want to give a little bit of background on some of the efforts that we're doing and some of the programs that we're building here at the University of Nebraska. And so with that, Conor, please feel free to take over whenever you're ready.
Awesome. Thanks, Dr. Bell. And first off, I just want to thank the consortium for the opportunity to speak today. I'm really humbled to be able to be invited to speak to a group like this, and especially on Earth Day too. I think that's really awesome. I wanted to start off with a quick note on equity. I think this is something that the scientific community could really get behind, and it could help advance democratic ideals, which are really fragile right now in the world, as we all know. And it could also help promote equity and climate justice. So in climate science, we often talk about systems-based thinking or systems-based approach, especially when we're talking about approaching solutions to climate change. And one of those is investing in human capital through education. And it's an important step that we as a global society are gonna have to take to overcome climate change. And when we combine prejudice and power, we see a systems advantage. And right now, that's what we see in higher education. There's a well-documented prejudice against the admittance of low socioeconomic status students. And colleges and universities, they hold the power as the avenue or the vehicle of opportunity in Western society today. And they kind of sort the haves from the have-nots. So I'll read a quote from Lonnie Guinier. She's the first woman of color appointed to tenured professorship at Harvard Law School. And she argues that the merit system that dictates the admission practices that these institutions are functioning to select elite privileged individuals rather than create learning communities geared to advance democratic societies. Guinier argues that reformation needs to happen not only on the very premise of admissions practices, but on the shape of higher education itself. And she offers many examples of new collaborative initiatives that prepare students to engage in citizenship in our increasingly multicultural society. And the reason this is important is because people educate their communities and their social networks, and we can't leave an entire group of people out of that education. I think a shift in higher education like this could promote a broader shift on the perspective of climate change. And that's really important as we move forward. And I bring this up because we all have the power to advocate within our institutions. We do this already for climate change, and we could do that with this issue as well. And we could advocate for things like class-based affirmative action, reducing the advantages that are given to affluent students, or expanding enrollment by democratizing education with the technology that we have today. because ultimately at the end of the day, having higher education be a hyper-competitive sorting machine is bad for our educational mission, and it's bad for equity, and that means it's bad for climate change as well. Next slide, please. And this is a quote that when I was first doing interviews with faculty at UNMC, one of the doctors, they told me this. They said, advocating for change within higher education can be like operating a cargo ship. And it was something that just stuck with me. It stuck in my mind. And I still use it today. So when I first heard this quote, I kind of got my wheels spinning. So next slide, please. And this is what I thought. This is what I thought it was going to be. I thought it was going to be me and Dr. Bell trying to get this giant cargo ship stuck from the Suez Canal. But it actually didn't end up being that case. And you'll see why on the next slide. So it wasn't the case that we were going to be on our own trying to operate this cargo ship through the Suez Canal, because there was a vision from leaders. And I wanted to point out some of those people, like Alan Ndogu from UCSF and Sarah and Natasha from Medical Students for a Sustainable Future. Chris, he's a colleague at UNMC, and we co-chair the Healthy Earth Alliance, which we'll talk about a little bit later. And then Ben and Emmeline from Emory. And then also Dr. Bell, my faculty mentor, he's been pivotal in all of this. And then Dr. Sheffield, Dr. Jackson, and Dr. Phillips Bourne, they're really thought leaders on this for the nation. So they've been on the cutting edge of all this. So they really built the foundation that we can now just build on top of. Next slide, please. So when we first started this initiative and Dr. Bell brought me onto the team, we didn't have a lot planned out. We knew that we wanted to integrate climate change and health relevant information into courses at the College of Medicine. And we wanted to start with the College of Medicine because a lot of things trickle down from the College of Medicine, at least here at UNMC. So we thought that we could build a framework out at the College of Medicine, and then we could use that framework to then lay on top of College of Nursing, Pharmacy, Dentistry, Allied Professions, and Public Health. And one of the things when I was first doing my literature search at the very beginning and reaching out to different programs that were integrating this themselves was I came across the Planetary Health Report Card. And this was a kind of a pivotal moment for me, at least, because it showed exactly where the opportunities were at the institution. So we could see and grade our own institution in these five categories. So we could look at the curriculum, research opportunities, community outreach and advocacy, support for student-led planetary health initiatives, and then campus sustainability. And we looked at each five of those, and now we're working on each five of those as well. Next slide, please. So surveys have been really important in one, gathering support, but two, just gathering information so that we can talk about what faculty and students are thinking on the topic of climate change and health. Because we don't want leadership just to take it from us. We want it to be something that has broad support. So you can see just a couple of questions from one of the surveys that we sent out. It's asking faculty whether this is something that they're teaching now. And we found that most faculty are not teaching on this topic at all. But most faculty are interested in teaching on this topic, or at least learning more about it. So this is data that we can use to put in our curriculum proposal. And it's also data that we can go to the curriculum committee and say, again, you don't have to take it from us. Like, your faculty, they're not teaching on this now, but they want to be. They know it's an important issue. Next slide, please. And this is another survey. This was given to students. And we really wanted students to have a voice in this matter as well. We knew that a lot of change at UNMC, it happens because students get on board. So here's a couple of questions that we asked in this survey. And it shows that there's a really big disparity between what's being taught and what they think ought to be taught. So most students think that they're rarely or never getting any information on climate change and how it relates to medicine. But most students would like to have that type of content, either always, very often, or sometimes, over 75% of students. So there's a visible gap here. And again, we can bring that to the leadership and say, hey, this is probably something that we should address. Most of the students here think they need to be learning about this topic. Next slide, please. And this is, just briefly wanted to touch on a survey that we're gonna be sending out this summer. So we're gonna be sending out a survey to public health professionals all across the state of Nebraska. This is gonna be going out to local health departments, but also going out to health professionals within the University of Nebraska system. And we've already sent a similar survey out to medical professionals in Nebraska. And this is really to gauge the competency and appetite for planetary health information. And then afterwards, once we gather the data and analyze it, we're gonna create medical education around some of the topics that were that we identified after analyzing that data. And then we're going to also create useful educational resources for practicing health professionals. And like I said, this is gonna be administered, well, after finals sometime. Next slide. And the Healthy Earth Alliance, this has been a lot of fun for me. The Healthy Earth Alliance is our student-led group. It was created by two medical students, Thomas Schroeder and DJ Marr, and they were passionate about sustainability within healthcare. I think the idea came to DJ when he was at a party with Thomas Schroeder, and they got to talking, and both of them had some similar interests, and they said, let's do this, let's make this happen. And that group, it got started a couple of years ago, but it wasn't until this last year that the attendance grew from about 9 students to over 60 plus students now from all healthcare colleges. So we have medical students, dentistry students, pharmacy, nursing, allied professions, and public health as well. And what we did with the group when I got involved was we set up a committee structure. We wanted the students to have some sort of accountability and authority within the group. So we set up this committee structure. We have 5 different committees: research, sustainability, community outreach, advocacy, and education. And we have 2 co-chairs for each of those committees. And now we've got a group of students who are really involved, really active, and they're all pushing for change at their individual schools, which is great. We've also become a partner affiliate with Medical Students for a Sustainable Future. That's helped immensely with our curriculum proposal and gathering resources. We also are now working with the new Chief Sustainability Officer. And this came because Thomas Schroeder, he was the Senate President at UNMC, and he invited us to talk to the Board of Regents about divestment. When we gave that speech, they decided that they were gonna be hiring a new Chief Sustainability Officer and working on divestment within within UNMC. So they invited our group because we gave that speech. to talk with the Chief Sustainability Officer. And since we've actually gotten more policy passed, we've talked with the Board of Regents again, giving them a statement about investments. And just last week, they passed a policy that's now going to be in our investment strategy, where they're going to focus on ESG, which stands for Environmental Sustainability and Governance, which you think all of these things are important steps to move the university forward. We also host informational webinars. So just last week, we brought in the consulting group that is working with UNMC on the sustainability measures that Dr. Bell mentioned at the beginning of this presentation. And they just talked to students about what we're doing and how we could get involved. We also have students from UNMC and Creighton who wrote up an op-ed on climate change. And this was actually published in the Omaha World Herald for Earth Day last year. Next slide, please. And this slide, this just goes over the new EMIT course that we're, or EMIT track that we're proposing. So the Enhanced Medical Education track, it offers medical students an opportunity to perform an in-depth study on an interdisciplinary field of medicine. And ours that we're proposing is going to focus on 100 hours of research that'll be done in between the M1 and M2 year. There's a break in between that summer that students have. So what we'll do is we'll set up cohorts of students with a research lab, and they'll do 100 hours of research focused on climate change and health. And we're working with the Internal Medicine Research Council to actually set up those labs for the new cohorts. And we'll also, the end goal of the EMIT will be for them to have a poster presentation at a national meeting in their M4 year. But sprinkled throughout their M1 through M4, there will be facilitated learning. And I've been conducting faculty interviews for faculty who are interested in volunteering some of their time, just like an hour or two, to facilitate some sort of learning around climate change and health. Next slide, please. And here's some of the language that we're proposing. We thought that amending some of the policies were important just to have that language of planetary health or environmental health actually present in the policy for our curriculum. So under medical knowledge, we just propose of adding that highlighted red area. And next slide, please. This is the same thing here. We just thought it was important to have that language present in the policy. So again, you can see that we just threw in environment there for patient care and clinical skills. Next slide, please. And this is the same thing here for systems of healthcare. Next slide. And again, this is the guiding principles of our curriculum process. We just thought it was important to throw in planetary health there. It's definitely not the most important part of what we're trying to advocate for, but having that language present, we think, is important enough. So we are proposing this to our curriculum committee. Next slide, please. And then that brings us to our curriculum proposal. So the curriculum proposal, the first part of it is just a quick introduction, why we think UNMC should care about it, why we think Nebraska should care about it. And then we have the proposal broken up into two main sections. The first is preclinical curriculum for M1 and M2 students. And then we also have the clinical curriculum for M3 and M4 students. And right now, our main focus is on that preclinical curriculum. We're trying to help implement some of this content into those didactic years. So on the right, you can see this is just an example of how we've actually implemented it already. And these were the learning objectives. And then you can see the clinical relevance and then a couple of sources that we can pull from. And then just below, this was to make it easier for us in actually implementing. We put the block, the lecture, the professor, and their email so that all of the information that you might need to actually get this implemented is all right there in one place. And next slide, please. And this is what it actually looked like. So I worked with one of our professors of psychiatry, and she put together, or me and her put together, a case study on Greta Thunberg, and there was a mental status exam. We had some clips from Greta's life. We also went through some of the new terminology like eco-anxiety and eco-grief, what that could mean with the DSM-5 or the next version of the DSM. Next slide, please. And this is just animation. I'm sure everybody on the call has seen it. This is provided by the CDC, and I thought it was important to put up because this really gives us a good framework to work from. Like, when we think about advocating for this within our institutions, I think we get overwhelmed oftentimes. And a lot of people, they say that they don't have the expertise, and this is not really something that they want to bite off. But all of the research is already out there. There's going to be some cutting edge research that comes out, and we need to re-up some of this curriculum. But there's so much information that's already out there and already provided that we can just take from it and pull from it. And you can see in each one of these categories how easily it would tie back to medicine or healthcare in some way. So the dots are already connected for us. We just have to use that framework that's already built out. And the next slide will also show another example of that. Next slide, please. So again, this just shows you what's the environmental and institutional, social and behavioral, how those play into the climate drivers and health outcomes that we see because of climate change. I think everybody is well aware who's on this call of how climate change is impacting health. And again, these resources are out there for everybody. So we just need to use them. Next slide, please. And these were some of the biggest challenges that I heard, at least when I was conducting faculty interviews and also talking to students. The biggest thing was time. And that has come up over and over. People, they either don't have time to dedicate to making the content, or they don't think that they have time within their lecture, or they don't think students have time to learn about this. Even though it is a critically important topic. The second biggest was expertise. I think people, they were a little skittish to talk about the topic because they themselves weren't experts. And so they just would rather not talk about it at all. The third was just a lack of an institutional framework. There wasn't, when I did my literature search, there's not really a framework that you can just pull from and you say, okay, this is how we get climate change integrated into our curriculum at X school. That's not out there yet, but there are a lot of resources that are helpful. The fourth, and I think, you know, there is a lack of institutional framework because of the fourth reason here, which is a lack of national accreditation requirements, we have almost every medical society in the world has some component that talks about climate change, but yet we still have national accreditation that has no requirements for climate change in the curriculum. So that's an issue and something we should definitely be looking at and working on. Next slide, please. And these were some of the solutions that we came up for those issues and challenges. The biggest was student involvement. Once we got the students involved, that's when we saw a sea shift in faculty as well, where at first we were kind of, there was more closed doors than open doors. Now that we have HEAL growing and we've had students advocating and talking about this within each college, we've seen things pick up really quickly. And we also have more hands available and more minds available to help us create some of this content. And students, they're really, I think when people get passionate about climate change, they're really motivated. So on this topic in particular, we see students who put in a lot of time and effort, and it's been critically important for us in moving our initiatives forward. So I imagine that it could be the same at other universities as well. The second is funding. Money talks, we know that. So whether that's grants or in our case, a gift, money is always helpful. Three is using published research that's already out there and using the networks that are already out there, like the Global Consortium on Health Education, like Medical Students for a Sustainable Future, because they have the resources, like the Medical Student for a Sustainable Future, they have a curriculum guide that can help guide you through creating a curriculum proposal to then send to your curriculum committee. All these things are really helpful, and we don't have to recreate the wheel or bang our heads up against a wall because it's already out there. Next slide, please. And this is just a timeline at UNMC. So you'll see that it was started not too long ago, these initiatives. There was a discussion about HEAL, the student-led group, and then the formation of HEAL just a couple years ago. And then we've had some HEAL activities, and it wasn't until you'll see spring 2021, that's now, that a lot of this has really picked up. And again, that's because, Dr. Bell and the Water, Climate, and Health Program, but also because we have expanded student involvement and we've gotten faculty and leadership at UNMC to start talking about this and take notice. Next slide, please. And these are some of our next steps. So next steps at UNMC, we're going to administer the survey to Nebraskan health professionals. The survey that I'm creating is going to go to public health professionals in particular. And then we're going to create a continued medical education course. We're also going to create resources for the healthcare community in Nebraska. And that'll be assessed once we analyze the information that comes back from those surveys. And then we're also going to apply for the enhanced medical education track and screen for our first cohort in the fall. We also are going to continue working with faculty to create slides. Like the example that we had with Dr. Edwards, we'll keep doing that with the students on the education committee through HEAL and myself and anybody else who wants to get involved and create some of this content. What we've noticed is that when you bring this idea up to faculty who are also passionate about climate change, oftentimes they just want to do it themselves. They didn't need any help. They already, this was on their mind. They just hadn't incorporated it into their lectures. And then we'll also continue advocating for policy change, like the divestment from fossil fuel. We'll keep pushing for those things through HEAL. Also, we will be expanding research opportunities for residents. Next slide, please. This is just next steps continued. We'll also have fellowship opportunities for University of Nebraska students, be applying for pilot grants. We'll also have Nebraska Water and Health Summit this summer. And then next year, we'll have the Nebraska Climate Summit. That'll be next fall. And then we also hope to expand the team by having new faculty hires. And this is important because we want to keep creating these coalitions and building on the momentum that we have now. Next slide, please. And here's just some closing thoughts. Kind of circling back to the beginning of this presentation, we think that climate justice should be at the center of every climate change conversation. When we're talking about making big institutional change, we should keep in mind climate justice because these solutions could be lasting. Before I gave this presentation to Dr. Bell, I actually had over here, instead of this picture of HEAL cleaning up a park, I had a picture of sunset, or what would have been a beautiful sunset that was covered up by smoky skies, because I live in Washington, and every summer we've been having horrendous fires, and so I really wanted to highlight the urgency of now. We don't have time to sit and deliberate. I think we need to get some of these initiatives up and off the ground. If they're not at your school, then it's on you. It's our responsibility to create these coalitions and make it happen. And I think part of that is living up to the ideals that the scientific community set out with. The scientific community is seeking truth and trying to uncover truth. We have to live by the ideals that we set out with. There's also a lot to be gained by combining expertise. Some of what we think of as climate science, maybe others don't. So it's important to bring together and combine expertise and make sure that the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. And with that, like Dr. Bell said at the beginning, Nebraska and UNMC, we're still pretty early on in our journey. So there's multiple opportunities to address this issue. And if you're early on in your journey as well, then that just means that you have all the opportunities in the world in front of you to address. So just pick one and get started. And that's all I have.
Thank you so much, Conor. That was an outstanding presentation. And Dr. Bell, thank you so much as well. And I just wanted to point out a few things that I really enjoyed in particular from your presentation is your discussion at the beginning of equity and the important role that higher education can play in not only promoting equity, but also in addressing climate change and the health impacts of climate change, and ensuring that health professionals and our workforce are provided with this information that they need to then do their jobs successfully. And then also I really enjoyed, and I felt like this was really emphasized, was the integration of sustainability and investment strategies at the university, in addition to the different curriculum that you displayed with the integration of climate and planetary health topics. But, you know, it's just so great to see the university also emphasizing, you know, sustainability practices. And also, you know, you said it so well that, you know, these resources are available, they're out there. So different institutions that are looking to for ways to integrate this topic or, you know, how to approach leadership at their school. You just provided some excellent examples. So thank you so much. And I just want to open it up to the members at this time to see if we have any questions. So I'm going to go ahead and stop our recording. And if you have a question, please feel free to unmute your line and go ahead and ask a question.